So let me start by introducing our first speaker. It's my pleasure to welcome Professor V. Kumaran. He is a professor at the Department of Chemical Engineering at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He is also an alumnus of IIT Madras, the host institute for this meeting. Professor Kumaran's research is quite diverse, with notable contributions in flow past flexible surfaces and granular materials. So, with this short introduction, I request Professor Kumaran to deliver this talk. So, please take 25 minutes for the talk, and then we can follow it up with the question and answer session. So over to you, Professor Kumaran.
Yeah, thank you, Sumesh, and thank you to the organizers, Mahesh Anubhav, for inviting me for this special occasion to celebrate Professor Balachander's 60th birthday. Right now, unfortunately, we cannot meet in person, so there's no going to be no banquet session for us to reminisce about our past association with Professor Balachander. So I thought I will give my reminiscences here itself before we go on to the talk. As Anupa and Sumesh said, both Bala and I are from the same institution. Unfortunately, he graduated, well, I mean, unfortunately for me, he graduated in 1983, and I entered the institution in 1983. So I did not have an opportunity to meet him in person at that time, but I did hear a lot about him, and that he had gone to pursue his PhD at Brown after graduation. Of course, I met him many years later, maybe a couple of decades ago, and like everybody else who's been associated with him, he leaves a deep impression on everyone. And for that reason, it is a great honor for me to be here to deliver a talk on his 60th birthday. 60th birthday is actually special in the Indian calendar because, you know, we have daily cycles, weekly cycles based upon the phases of the moon, annual cycle based upon the sun. And then we have a 60-year cycle. And the 60-year cycle, each year has a particular name. And so this is the same year that Bala was born, actually. And it is said that the lifespan of a person is two such 60-year cycles. So I'd like to congratulate Bala on successfully completing one cycle and look forward to the second one. And I actually took the trouble of finding out the fortune cookie equivalent of the prediction for people who are born on this year. It's called Subhakritu in this year's cycle. And it says, principled one, bent on doing good things to others, he will also learn many sciences and live long. So I thought that rather described Bala rather well. And I've been always been grateful for the association with him. He has always been so hospitable whenever I've visited Florida, and taken great interest in what we did. And I always enjoyed the conversations. And I'm sure he is going to have his opinions about what I'm going to present, and I look forward to hearing them. This talk, I have made it a little more general and given a little more background because the audience is more general than just on multi-phase flows. But if you want any details at the end, I'll be happy to provide them. Okay, so this is about some of the work that we've done on what we call turbulence collapse. This is a collaboration with IIT Bombay, Pradeep Muramulla and Partha Goswami at IIT Bombay, and Ankit Tyagi and myself here at Indian Institute of Science. And I'd like to acknowledge Department of Science and Technology and the Jain Tata Trust. Before I proceed, I should congratulate Bala on both the IUTAM Award as well as the Distinguished Alumnus Award for IIT Madras. Unfortunately, we did not have an opportunity to meet at that time, but I hope we'll meet again when he comes to receive the award. So with this, I'll start my talk. Gas particle suspensions, broadly divided into different categories, colloidal, aerosols, suspensions, and granular materials. And we work mostly in suspensions and granular materials. And the classification that we use is based upon what are the dominant forces that are in the suspension for particles of that particular size. The salient feature of these particle gas suspensions is that the gas phase has a density that is approximately 1,000 times smaller than the particle phase. And therefore, you can have particle inertia being important, but not the inertia of the gas around the particle. The terminal velocity of a particle increases as d squared because the drag force is proportional to diameter, whereas the weight goes as the diameter cubed. On the other hand, the Brownian diffusivity decreases as inverse of the diameter, right? Because the Stokes drag law, the drag coefficient is proportional to the diameter. And so if you calculate ratios, the Peclet number goes as d to the 4, okay? Because it has a terminal velocity on top, diameter, and a Brownian diffusivity. And Reynolds number goes as d cubed, and Stokes number also goes as d cubed. But the Reynolds number is based upon the gas density, and the Stokes number is based upon the particle density. And therefore, there's a factor of about 1,000. Okay? So the Stokes number is typically a factor of 1,800 or so larger than the Reynolds number. And the typical values I've shown at the bottom, the gas density is about 1 kg per meter cubed, 1.25 at STP. The particle density is about 8,000 to 2,000 to 8,000. The viscosity of the gas is 10 power minus 5. For colloidal suspensions, the Peclet number is small compared to one. So Brownian motion is dominant, and the particles typically cross streamlines as they are buffeted by the thermal mass. Okay. And the Stokes number is very small, and the Reynolds number is very small. When you go to aerosols, the Peclet number is actually large, which means that Brownian motion is not of great significance. Okay. The Reynolds number is still small, and the Stokes number is still small. And so for particles in the 1 to 10 micron range, which have been of great interest these days because of aerosols that transmit COVID, they actually follow the streamlines. And that's the reason that they can get through your nose and get through your mouth and get to the lungs. Okay. If they were smaller, then they would get stuck in the nose. If they were larger, because of inertia, they do not follow the streamlines. And the next is suspension, about 10 to 100 microns. And here, Brownian motion is not important. The Reynolds number is still relatively small, but the Stokes number is large. That means that particle inertia is large. And there is a balance between particle inertia and the fluid viscosity. And you go to a larger size, greater than 100 microns, the fluid more or less does not matter. Okay? The system is dominated by particle inertia and contact dissipation due to the interactions between particles. Okay. So most of my work has been on granular materials, but today I'll talk about suspensions, 10 to 100 microns in diameter, particle gas suspensions, and look at, and these typically, the fluid is turbulent, and then you have particles there. So the particles exert a force on the fluid because of inertia, and the fluid exerts a reverse force because of the fluid velocity fluctuations. So there's a question of how the fluid affects the particles and how the particles affect the fluid. There has been extensive work in this area. I won't go into the details because of the shortage of time. But what I will say is that give you a gross simplification of what is known in the state of the art. For Reynolds number, particle Reynolds number less than about 10, you have roughly four-arc symmetry. 10 to about 150, you have a wake form, you have a separation bubble at the rear. And beyond this, you have a wake, and then there is a wake, there's a vortex shedding, and then there is turbulence in the wake, and so on. Okay. And it is generally believed that small particles attenuate turbulence. And this is important. The attenuation is because of enhanced dissipation due to particle drag. In other words, you have an additional mechanism for the dissipation of energy in addition to the energy dissipation in turbulence. And because there's this additional dissipation going on, the turbulence gets attenuated. Now, whereas large particles, you can believe enhanced turbulence because of the wake, the vortex shedding, and so on. And so this is the mechanism, the effect of small particles that we were trying to analyze using direct numerical simulations. So this is the system, a two-dimensional channel flow. X is the vertical direction, the direction along the flow, and Z is the spanwise direction. The system is periodic in the X and Z directions, and there are solid walls in the Y direction. In this case, the gravity is acting downwards, but as I will show a little later, this is not so important. And we did it at relatively low Reynolds numbers for the channel, 3300 and 5600. The reason is because, as you will see, we had to probe a relatively large parameter space in order to detect these effects, and this required a very large number of simulations. The friction Reynolds number is 115 and 180, and even though the Reynolds number is relatively small, it is still in the turbulent regime because the transition to turbulence takes place at a Reynolds number between 1300 and 1800. Okay. Fluid phase, Navier-Stokes equations, mass and momentum conservation for an incompressible fluid. Incompressible because we have periodic boundary conditions, and so the volume occupied by the particles is a constant, which means that the volume occupied by the fluid has to be a constant. And the only additional thing we have here is a drag force, and that is the force exerted by the particles on the fluid. Okay? And the particle volume fraction is very small. It's about 4 into 10 power minus 3, but because of the density ratio, the mass fraction is much larger. The mass of solids to the particles to the mass of fluid could be up to 8,000 in our simulations. And the simulations are done by the pseudospectral method, okay, Chebyshev in the wall normal direction and Fourier in the other two directions, which are periodic. I've shown the expansion here. This is standard. It's been known for 30, 40 years. And just to show that we have managed to get sufficient resolution for the Reynolds numbers that we are analyzing. And this is a comparison with the classic work of Kim Moin and Moser, which was done many years ago, 35 years ago or so. And you can see we capture accurately the mean velocity and the root mean square of the fluctuating velocities. So the DNS for an unladen channel flow is accurately captured by these simulations. And I will also state this here, and I will come back to it later. Typically, if you try to do a turbulent simulation, channel flow simulation, and you start off with the laminar flow and crank up the Reynolds number, it will continue to be laminar. And you need to go to a relatively large Reynolds number. You need to impose a relatively large perturbation on the flow in order to get the flow to become turbulent. Okay. That is well known in the field of direct numerical simulations, but may not be as well known for a general audience. So particles are treated as discrete particles. Mass times acceleration is equal to sum of forces. One is the gravitational force. As I said, for our simulations, it turns out to not be that important because the particle terminal velocity is about 1/100 of the mean flow velocity. Okay. But therefore, the gravitational force is negligible compared to particle drag. The other forces, however, are important. Okay. There is a drag force. Okay. And for that, we use a Shiller-Naumann correlation. This is once again standard, this correlation that takes into account the inertial effects, a modification of Stokes' drag law, where u is the fluid velocity and v is the particle velocity. And this leads to a viscous relaxation time that has this form. One has to be careful here because in Stokes' law, the velocity of the fluid is the undisturbed velocity at the particle center if the particle were absent. The presence of the particle causes a disturbance, and this disturbance has to be subtracted out if you want to get the drag force exactly. And we do that. We subtract out the disturbance due to the particle, and calculate the undisturbed velocity in order to calculate the track force. And we take into account the effect of wall on the track force. As a particle gets close to the wall, the track force changes, and we use a correlation for that. And that correlation is from a paper by Bala, actually, in 2009. There is a Safman lift force. The lift could be due to two different effects. One is due to the shear rate at the center of the particle, and the other is due to the velocity difference between the particle and the fluid. Okay. It turns out that for our configuration, the force due to the shear rate is actually dominant compared to the force due to the relative velocity. So we take into account the Safman lift force, and we also take into account a wall correction for the Safman lift force. Okay. I won't go into the details, but these once again are correlations that were first proposed by McLaughlin, I think, in the 90s. Particle-particle and particle wall collisions. To keep the system simple, we have not taken into account the dissipation in particle-particle and particle wall collisions, because we would like to examine the effect of the drag force. So we assume that the particle-particle and particle wall collisions are elastic, hard sphere, specular reflection from the wall, okay? The simplest possible assumption. Okay? However, the phenomena that I will be showing do apply even when there is particle rotation, particle roughness, particle friction, and so on. And I will not be able to go through that in the present talk, but I will only show you what the results for elastic hard sphere particles. And how do we impose the drag force on the particle? So if a particle is in a particular cell, we section the cell into 8 subcubes whose planes intersect at the particle center. And the force that is exerted on one of the nodes is based upon the lever rule. So it is proportional to the volume of the opposite node. Okay, it's just like a lever rule in one dimension, wherein the force on one side is proportional to the length on the other side. Okay, so we use the same. Okay, and so this is called the projection on nearest neighbors method. And this force is inserted as a delta function, okay, in the fluid momentum equation. I can go into the details of that later, but for now I'll just say that the force is imposed on the 8 vertices of the cube within which the particle is located. And these are the parameters: density, viscosity. Particles are solid spheres, interact through elastic collisions. And if you want to make a comparison to real systems, the particle diameter for the parameters we use would be approximately 40 microns. And the mass would be about 500 to 8,000 kilograms per meter cube. So just a summary of everything. Particle Reynolds number is about 4 to 15. Okay. And so in that case, the Shiller-Naumann correlation applies. Okay. So there's a big difference between the particle Reynolds number based upon the average flow velocity, which is 60 to 103, and the particle Reynolds number based upon the average relative velocity between the particle and the fluid, which is actually much smaller. Okay. So this Reynolds number is what the drag force is based upon, and we have a particle Stokes number. Volume fraction is small, up to 3 into 10 power minus 3, but the mass loading is large, as I said, greater than 10. And these are the particle diameter to channel width and the particle diameter to Kolmogorov scale, roughly of the same magnitude. And in this case, you have a fluid integral time scale, a particle relaxation time, and a collision time. This particle relaxation time to fluid integral time scale is essentially the Stokes number. Okay, then there's a collision time. So I'll just say it here that we consider both situations where the particle relaxation time is larger and smaller than the fluid time scale. And we consider cases where the relaxation time is smaller and larger than the collision time. Okay? So we consider cover all parameters spaces. Okay? So we do the simulation, and here is what we see. You see two graphs here. The channel configuration is symmetric, so I've shown only one half of the statistics for each graph. On the left side, left half is the mean velocity. Left side, right half is the mean square velocity in the x direction. Right side left half is the mean square velocity in the wall normal direction, and right side right half is the Reynolds stress. Okay, and this is for an unladen layer. Okay, and if we slowly keep adding particles, here's what happens. Okay, so 5 into 10 power minus 4 volume fraction. Okay, and you can see there's a slight turbulence attenuation. It increases when you go to 9 into 10 power minus 4, and then when you go into 1 into 10 power minus 3, you can see that there's a decrease, as I will show, by about one order of magnitude in the turbulence fluctuations, both in the stream-wise direction, the wall normal direction, and the span-wise direction. And if you look closely at the left half of the left graph, you will see that there's a distinct change in the mean velocity profile as well. Okay, it changes from something that looks like a plug flow to something that looks closer to a parabolic. Okay, and all of these things happen when the volume fraction changes by 1 × 10⁻⁴. Okay, so you add a slight bit of particles, and then suddenly you see the precipitous drop in the turbulence intensities. Okay. And then when you increase it further, the intensities remain roughly the same. And this happens for different Reynolds numbers, different particle volume fractions, different particle mass densities, different Stokes numbers, and so on. Okay. We can quantify this by defining measures of the departures from a turbulent velocity profile. Delta UX square is roughly how much the velocity profile changes from a turbulent velocity profile for an unladen flow. Okay. And then we can also do cross-sectional averages of the velocity fluctuations. And here's what you see. Okay, the departure from an unladen turbulent profile shows, I've shown the results here for Stokes' law for the Shiller-Naumann correlation at 3300, for the Shiller-Naumann correlation at 5600. And I will also show you results that include the Safman lift, the corrections of the drag force, the corrections for the undisturbed velocity, and so on. All of these show a similar trend. You see a roughly an order of magnitude increase in this departure from the turbulent unladen velocity, and an order of magnitude decrease in the intensity of the turbulent fluctuations in all cases. Okay, and it's independent of the Stokes number, the Reynolds number, and so on. Okay, you see it in all cases. The volume fraction at which there is this precipitous drop changes as you change parameters, but the fact that this happens does not change. And this happens for the mean square velocity in the wall normal direction, as well as the mean square velocity in the span-wise direction. So you can plot the volume fraction at which the critical volume fraction at which this transition happens. And you can see that it does depend upon Stokes' number. Okay? But it does depend a little bit on what the forces in the particles are. Okay? But you see this transition repeatedly. Okay? And if you look at the fluid side, if you look at the particle statistics, there's not that much happening. Okay, the volume fraction is roughly a constant across. The mean velocity is actually roughly a constant. Okay, there's a substantial slip at the wall in comparison to the curved line, which is the fluid velocity fluctuation. And the mean square velocities do change, but they do not change by a factor of 10. They change only by a factor of 2 or so, okay, when this transition takes place. And the same thing for the mean square velocity and the Reynolds stress in the particles. And so you see the slight change here, and that change is actually because of the change in the mean velocity profile, not because the particle fluctuations are changing. It's because the particle mean velocity, the fluid mean velocity has changed. And you see this for the other correlations as well, the span-wise and the Reynolds stress. Okay, so why does this happen? Okay. Initially I said that it's because the drag force increases that it is postulated that there's turbulence attenuation. And the red term here is the Reynolds stress, and the blue term here is the drag force. As we go across the transition from the left to the right, okay, you can see that the blue term does not change very much. Okay, it's the red term that precipitously collapses. Okay, so it's the turbulence production of energy that is collapsing. Okay, it's not due to an enhanced drag force on the particle, on the fluid by the particles, and it is not continuous as you would expect if it were due to an enhanced drag. And you can see it in the kinetic energy budget as well. Okay, the brown term is the dissipation of energy to the mean flow. The red term is the turbulence production of energy. And the blue term is the dissipation of energy due to particle drag. And you can see between the left and the right graphs, the blue term does not change very much, but it's the red term due to the production of energy that is changing precipitously. Okay. And I just plotted the integral measures of these terms here. And they sort of show the same thing. It's the red term that is decreasing sharply and going almost to zero. Okay, the other terms actually increase. Okay, the viscous dissipation of energy decreases, but the drag force actually increases, okay, as you go through this transition. And what I've shown you is a direct numerical simulation of turbulent particle gas suspensions shows a discontinuous reduction in the fluid turbulence intensities to near zero at critical volume loading of about 10 power minus 3. And that is not because there is a continuous enhancement in the dissipation of energy due to the particle drag, but rather because there's a collapse in the turbulent energy production rate. And there is no compensatory increase in the dissipation due to particles at that particular point. Okay. And this leads to a decrease in the total energy dissipation rate. And that decreases the pressure drop by 25 to 35% at this transition level. Okay. So with that, I will end my talk. I'll thank the organizers once again for giving me this opportunity to present my work here at Bala's birthday celebrations. The 60th birthday is actually quite an auspicious occasion for us. There are many celebrations and rituals to be done. And if any of you would like to organize something for Bala, I'll be happy to give you information on that. With that, I will thank you all very much. Happy birthday, Bala, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Kumaran. We have time for a couple of questions. I guess panelists will be able to unmute themselves and ask. Attendees can type the questions in the Q&A box. Yeah, Professor Balchandra.
Maybe I will start the question. Kumaran, a very interesting talk.
Thank you.
What happens when the flow direction is horizontal and you have buoyancy effects affecting the particles where energy has to be spent in suspending the particles?
Yeah. As I said, I mean, the gravitational force is actually not very large here in comparison to the force due to the fluid drag. It's only about 1% or so. 2 to 3% approximately. Okay, so it's not going to make that much of a difference to this phenomenon because we're working in a regime where the terminal velocity is much smaller than the flow velocity. Okay.
We did some work on not air water system. I mean, air gas particle system, but in water, sort of like sediments. We also observe this collapse that you were talking about, very interesting thing. But there, gravity plays a sort of a different role. Anyway, I will share that information and I will exchange the information with you. Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah, so the number of particles considered, it varies between 32,000 and 64,000 for the system that we are considering. And it's periodic boundary conditions. And these are spherical in shape. But we actually deal with these as point particles because they are much smaller than the size of the grid. So if you have some other shape, then you could include that as well. Only the force that you project onto the fluid grid will change. Yeah. That's in answer to the question that is asked in the Q&A.
Yeah. Any other questions? So meanwhile, I was also a bit confused. How do you find out the fluid velocity, the undisturbed fluid velocity that needs to be subtracted out?
Okay, yeah. So for the fluid velocity with the particle in it, right, you know what is the velocity disturbance exerted due to the on the fluid due to the presence of the particle. And there was this work which I had projected, which actually tells you how to subtract that disturbance, velocity disturbance due to the particle and get the undisturbed velocity of the fluid.
I see. Okay. Yeah. There's one more question on Q&A.
These are smooth particles right now, so there is no effect on angular momentum, but we have done simulations with rough particles as well. So the question was, what's the impact of projection on the cube on angular momentum? So we've done with rough particles as well, and you see the same phenomenon. In that case, basically, there will be a torque on the fluid exerted due to the particle, and that torque will be projected onto all the neighboring nodes. Yeah, Harish?
I'm just trying to figure it. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
So I wasn't familiar with that interesting fact that you raised out, I mean, which seems to be common in the DNS community, which is that if you keep pushing the laminar flow to higher and higher Reynolds number, it doesn't necessarily go to turbulence unless you perturb it.
Yes.
But I'm just curious, if you, the whatever standard protocol is followed to set up a turbulent flow, you're starting with particles at the beginning, is it?
Particles, particles in a turbulent flow. So the initial condition is a turbulent unladen flow. And then you create particles at random locations with random velocities, with the same mean velocity as the fluid, and then let the simulation run. Sure. And at some point, when you create those particles with a certain volume fraction higher than the critical value, the turbulence sort of discontinuously decreases to almost zero. And in that state, if you try to impose perturbations and kick up the turbulence again, you see it doesn't increase, even though the perturbation that you put is about 50% more than what you would put in order to get turbulence in an unladen flow. So we tried that. Yeah.
So, but do you to get reliable statistics?
Yeah.
Do you have to run? I mean, how do you know how long do you have to run this? These simulations for? I mean, perhaps you may have to run it for a very long time. I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, the students who do it figure it out pretty quickly. They'll predict the day before that, you know, it's going to decrease tomorrow. You know, so it's a matter of experience once you do it sufficient number of times.
Okay.
And the other thing is that, you know, if you take the laminar state with particles in it after the turbulence has collapsed, and you take out all the particles, and then you put a perturbation, then it goes back to a turbulent flow.
Okay.
On the other hand, if you have a turbulent flow and you take out the particles, it remains in turbulent flow. Laminar flow, if you take out the particles, it remains in laminar flow. Okay. And then you have to put in a perturbation to increase the turbulence. And I should also note here that this this is not due to a disruption of, you know, the eddy bursting at close to the wall and so on. Okay. That is the normal mechanism of turbulence generation. Okay. So we can sort of, you know, the eddy bursting mechanism is that the location where there's a peak in the root mean square fluctuating velocity in the streamwise direction. And we can artificially remove all particles from that location and leave particles everywhere else. Okay. Sure. Or load particles in that location and remove them everywhere else. And you see it doesn't have that much of an effect. Okay. So this is actually an interaction of particles with large scale structures, with structures of the same scale as the channel width. Okay.
So maybe with that note, we can conclude this talk. Thank you, Professor
Kumaran. Thank you.
Yeah.